Hey guys, Sherm here, and today I'm going to be testing the Saline S1 in multiplayer in Asphalt 9 in the current Ghost Slipstream season. I've managed to 3-star my car after getting actually a jackpot in the Drive Syndicate, which is the first jackpot I've gotten in a Drive Syndicate, and I wanted to see how it would do at 3 stars, and I have to say, I was pleasantly surprised. Please consider subscribing if you have not already, and check out my Furum Clips channel, as well as my Purple Team Discord. Links to those will be down in the description, and I hope you enjoy these races. I'm sure some of you may be wondering, why did I decide to 3-star this car? After all, you only need to add 2 stars in the Drive Syndicate in order to get to the Gallardo, which as a lot of you know, I'm well past at this point. Well, the thing is, when I was opening packs for this car, when I was only 1 or 2 blueprints away from getting it to 2-star, which I needed it at, I got my only jackpot ever in a Drive Syndicate for this car, and it boosted me to like 2/3 of the way to 3-star in just one pack. Now, obviously, I didn't know how many Syndicate coins I was going to need later in the event at that time, so I didn't spend any more Syndicate coins on it. As you guys may know, my main goal for the event was to unlock the GTR50. After I did that, I decided, hey, I'm only a few blueprints away from starring up the Saline, I might as well. It cost me, I want to say 15 or 20,000 Syndicate coins, which is less than one pack for the GTR50, so I'd say it wasn't too bad of a deal. Now, this does unfortunately mean that I will have one less 10x pack for the GTR50 to be able to buy, and it's already looking very close as to whether or not I'll actually be able to get it at 2 stars or not with the amount of Syndicate coins that I have. Now, if I get to like one blueprint away and I run out of Syndicate coins, then 3-starring this car might have been a mistake. But in any case, it doesn't really matter at this point. What's done is done, and I got some pretty great races out of it in this video. As you just saw, we had a very close battle, just barely passing a higher ranked Pininfarina, Gallardo, and 599XX Evo at the last second on New York. And now we have another close race on Osaka. I played these two races, one right after one another, after a couple of ones where I think I got knocked down or something. I was feeling a little bit disheartened, but these two races definitely helped lift my spirits a bit. And it helped me to know that this car actually had some life in it, because you see, it only goes 195 miles per hour normally. It is a perfect nitro car, so if you go into perfect nitro, you can go 200 miles per hour. And you have to remember, this is at 3 out of 4 stars in a lower mid-tier C-class car, at least where it's positioned in the class in the game. And I didn't find it to be as terrible as that makes it seem, at least in a lot of the races that I played. Now obviously, I did have some on like Himalayas, where I'd come up against a bunch of Arenaras going to 25, and of course there's nothing I could do about those there. After all, it is Slipstream, and the faster cars will generally win. But here, I actually did something slightly risky, which I don't usually do. I go over to the left at the end. It helps me. I'm able to pass somebody at the last second and come in first, again ahead of 2 Venser Sarths and a 599XX Evo. Now, the Venser Sarth and that Arenara Hesera are the two cars that I saw most often throughout this season, because they are by far the fastest cars in Class C. Now, the Gallardo is not too far behind, so I did see quite a few of those as well, and I will be uploading a video about my newly 3-starred Gallardo at some point in the near future too. It is decidedly better than the Saline, going 315 miles per hour with or without perfect nitro, compared to this car's 195 or 200, which is a 15 to 20 miles per hour difference, which definitely does make a big difference in a season where you're only playing in C-class cars, and especially being a Slipstream season, you typically want your car to be as close to the maximum top speed in the class as you can. You guys will be happy to know that after 3 years, I have finally maxed out my Bugatti Chiron. Did it just yesterday, actually. Unfortunately, I did not have enough tokens to start up completely, but I will do that to as much as I can with the amount of epic import parts that I have before I decide to test it, so we can really get just as much of a full true max test as we can in the car. Since the Chiron requires 8 extra epics to go from 5-star max to 6-star gold max, and I only had 5 before this epic pre, I will need 3 more from the epic pre in order to fully gold out the car. Now, out of the 5 that I had, I used 4 on fully gold maxing acceleration and nitro, as those are the most important stats of the Chiron. It's already much faster than almost any other car in the game, and the handling is good enough, and the drifting is as well, that you really don't need to upgrade handling all that much. I would argue that handling is probably the last thing that you really need to upgrade, at least worrying about epics on that car. So right now in the Grand Prix, as we're in the final round, which finishes not too long from now, I'm sitting in 8th position, which is smack dab in the middle of the 15 player bracket. I actually got into tier 2, so I will be getting one epic guaranteed from it, possibly some more in the pack, and I really don't think my position is going to be changing at this point, either up or down, because there's like 30 points in between me and both the person above me and the person below me. So hopefully I should be able to fully max out top speed without a problem on the Sheeran, and I will just not worry about the extra two epics on the handling. Now, obviously, if I get some extra ones in the extra packs that I'll be getting from the Epic Pre, that'll be great. I'll put them on, but I mean, it's not that big of a deal. So here we're coming up toward the end of this US Midwest race, a track that I've gotten very familiar with throughout the Drive Syndicate, as I'm sure many of you have as well. This is a 599XX Evo behind me. He was beginning to catch up to me pretty close to the finish line. Thankfully, though, I was able to keep the lead and take the victory here. He was a good, like, 850 ranks higher than me, though. That's the thing I noticed in most of the races that I played. When you are facing high-end C-class cars, they're going to be like 500 to 1,000 rank higher than you, and yet sometimes I was able to beat them. And I guess this brings me to my general review about this car. It is a relatively easy car to drive. It has pretty long-lasting nitro efficiency. The drifting is kind of meh, the handling is decent, the top speed isn't that great, but overall, it is fairly reliable. I didn't have a lot of instability issues with this car or anything like that, and so because of that, I was generally able to drive it very smoothly. And because of that, I think, that is what allowed me to win some of these races. Because almost every race that I did actually manage to do well in was extremely close, and I had little to no margin of error. And because of that, if I had made any little mistake in a lot of these races, it wouldn't have gone as well. And that did happen in some of the other ones that I played. So I wanted to show you that this car, I guess, isn't 100% useless. It still is mostly useless, and I can't really see people using this in a regular multiplayer season where you can use all the classes, but we got a perfect season to show it off just now. Probably would have been slightly better if it hadn't have been slipstream, so the Arenas and Venters couldn't have caught up to me so easily in some of the races, but we do manage to beat a Venter in this final race. Thank you all so much for watching. Please like the video if you have enjoyed, and consider subscribing for more Asphalt, Forza, and other games content, and I will see you in my next video. Goodbye!